when you observe yourself within, you see moving images, a world of images, generally known as fantasies. Is already there. You see, the child is not born tabula rasa, as one assumes. The child is born as a high complexity with existing determinants that never waver through the whole life, and that give the child his character already in the earliest childhood. A mother recognizes the an individuality of her child. And so if you observe carefully, you see the tremendous difference even in very small children. And these peculiarities express themselves in every way. So first the peculiarities express themselves in all childish activities, in the way how it plays, in the things it is interested in. There are children who are tremendously interested in all moving things, and the movement chiefly. All the things you see that affect the body. And so they are interested in what the eyes do, what the ears do, how far you can bore into the nose with your finger, you know. Okay. Now you see these things, these interests express themselves in a typically childish way in children, and later on they express themselves in other peculiarities, which are still the same, but it doesn't come from the fact that they once have done such a thing in childhood. It is the character that is doing it. There is a definite inherited complexity. You see, we are born into a pattern. We are a pattern. We are a structure that is pre-established through the genes. It is a biological order of our mental functioning, as for instance our biological or physiological function follows a pattern, or the behavior of any bird or insect follows a pattern, and that is the same with us. The man has a certain pattern that is makes him specifically human, and no man is born without it. We are only deeply unconscious of these facts because we live all by our senses and outside of ourselves. If a man could look into it himself, he would discover it. And when a man discovers it, in our days, he thinks he's crazy. And he may be crazy. Thank you.
There are, of course, great individual differences. There are individuals who have an amazing knowledge of themselves, of the things that go on in themselves. But even those people wouldn't be capable of knowing what is going on in their own cultures. Because they are not conscious of the fact that while they live a conscious life, all the time a myth is played in the unconscious. A myth that extends over centuries. Namely, archetypal ideas, stream of archetypal ideas that goes on through one individual, through the centuries. You see, it is like a continuous stream. And that comes then to the daylight in the great movements. Say, in political movements or in spiritual movements. For instance, in the time before Reformation, people dreamt of the great change. And that's the reason why such great transformations could be predicted. If somebody has been clever enough to see what is going on in people's mind, in the unconscious mind, would be able to predict it. For instance, I have predicted the Nazi rising in Germany through the observation of my German patients. They had dreams in which the whole thing was anticipated. And with considerable detail in the years before Hitler came, in the beginning of the, well, I could say the year 1919, I was sure that something was threatening in Germany, something very big and very catastrophic. Mm-hmm. And I only knew it through the observation of the unconscious. When you observe the world, you see people, you see houses, you see the sky, you see tangible objects. But when you observe yourself within, you see moving images, a world of images, generally known as fantasies. Yet these fantasies are facts. It is a fact that a man has such and such a fantasy. And it is such a tangible fact, for instance, that when a man has a certain fantasy, another man may lose his life. Or a bridge is built. These houses were all fantasies. Everything you do here, all of the houses, everything was fantasy to begin with. And fantasy has a proper reality. That is not to be forgotten. Fantasy is not nothing. It is, of course, not a tangible object. But it is a fact, nevertheless. It is a form of energy. Despite the fact we can't measure it. It is a manifestation of something. And that is a reality. That is just a reality as, for instance, the peace treaty of Versailles or something like that. Yeah. It is no more. You can't show it. But it has been a fact. And so the psychical events are facts, are realities. And when you observe the stream of images within, you observe an aspect of the world within. And so, you see, the man who is going by the external world, by the influences of the external world, say, society, or perceptions, sense perceptions, thinks that he is more valid, you know, because this is valid, this is real. And the man who goes by the subjective factor is not valid because subjective factor is nothing. Yeah. No, that man is just as well based because he is bases himself upon the world from within. And so he is quite right, even if he says, oh, this is nothing but my fantasy, you know. And of course that is the introvert. And as the introvert is always afraid of the external world, he will tell you, when you ask him, he will be apologetic about it. Yes, of course, yes, I know. Only my fantasies. And he has always resentment. And as the world in general, particularly America, is extroverted like hell, the introvert has no place. Because he doesn't know that he beholds the world from within. And that gives him dignity. And that gives him certainty. Because it is, nowadays particularly, the world hangs on a thin thread. And that is the psyche of man. Assume that certain fellows in Moscow lose their nerve or their common sense for a bit. And the whole world is in fire and flames. See? It is nowadays we are not threatened by elementary catastrophes. There is no such thing as an H-bomb. That is all man's doing. We are the great danger. The psyche is the great danger. What if something goes wrong with the psyche? See? And so you see, it is demonstrated to us in our days what the power of the psyche is of man, how important it is to know something about it, but we know nothing about it. A certain way of functioning, a certain pattern of behavior. And that is expressed in the form of archetypal images or archetypal forms. For instance, the way in which a man should behave is given by an archetype. And therefore, you see, the primitives tell such stories. A great deal of education goes through storytelling. You see, if you are unconscious about certain things that ought to be conscious, then you are dissociated. And then you are a man whose left hand never knows what the right is doing and counteracts or interferes with the right hand. Now such a man is hampered all over the place.
American life is in such a way so one-sided and so deracinated, uprooted, that you must have something to compensate the earth. You see, you have to pacify your unconscious all along the line because it is in absolute uproar. Yeah. So at the slightest provocation, you have a big moral rebellion in America. Look at the rebellion of modern youth in America. Yeah. The sexual rebellion and all that. Because the real natural man is just in open rebellion against the utterly inhuman form of life. They are absolutely divorced, you know, from nature, in a way, and that accounts for these that drug abuse.
I noticed with my patients, particularly with people that are in public life, that they have a certain way of presenting themselves. For instance, take the doctor. He has a certain way. For instance, he has good bedside manners, and he behaves as one expects a doctor behaves. He may even identify himself with it and believe that he is what he appears to be. And so when he's a professor, he's also supposed to behave in a certain way so that it is plausible that he is a professor, you know. So the persona is a certain complicated system of behavior, which is partially dictated by society and partially dictated by the expectations or the wishes one nurses oneself. Now, this is not the real personality, in spite of the fact that people will assure you that that is all quite real and quite honest, yet it is not. Now, such a performance, or say, yeah, the performance of the persona is quite all right, as long as you know that you are not identical with the way in which you appear. But if you are unconscious of this fact, then you get into sometimes very disagreeable conflicts. Namely, people will can't help noticing that at home, for instance, you are quite different from what you appear to be in public. And people who don't know it stumble over it in the end. They deny that they are like that, but they are like that. They are it. And then you don't know. Now, which is the real man? Is he the man as he is at home or in intimate relations? Or is he the man that appears in public? It is a question of Jekyll and Hyde. Often, it is such, occasionally there is such a difference that you would almost be able to speak of the double personality. And the more that is pronounced, the more people are neurotic. They get neurotic because they have two different ways. They contradict themselves all the time. And inasmuch as they are unconscious of themselves, they don't know it. They think they're all one. Everybody sees that they are two. And some know him only from one side, so others know him only from the other side. And then there are situations that clash, because the way you are creates certain situations with people in your relations, and these two situations don't chime in. They are just dissonances. For instance, take a singer.
Yes.
Who is absolutely controlling his voice. Suddenly he can't sing. Or any other, for take a man who writes fluently, suddenly he makes a ridiculous mistake. There his habit doesn't function. It may be, you know, that what the unconscious has to say is so disagreeable that one prefers not to listen. And in most cases, people would be probably less neurotic if they could admit the things. Because these things are always a bit difficult or disagreeable or inconvenient or something of the sort. So there is always a certain amount of repression. When in treatment, for instance, in the treatment of neurosis, you have to do with that personal unconscious for quite a while. And then only dreams come that show that the collective unconscious is touched upon.
Yes.
Now, as long as there is material for personal nature, you have to deal with the personal unconscious. But when you get to
say to a question, to a problem, which is no more merely personal, but also collective. You get collective dreams.
Thank you.
see, there is no system about it in therapy. In therapy, you treat the patient as he is in the present moment, irrespective of causes and such things. That is all more or less theoretical. There are cases who know just as much about their own neurosis as I know about it, in a way. In such cases, I can start right away with posing the problem. For instance, there is a case, a professor of philosophy, and he imagines that he has cancer. He shows me several dozen X-ray plates that prove that there is no cancer. And he says, of course I have no cancer, but nevertheless, I'm afraid I could have one. You see, I have consulted so many surgeons, and they all assure me there is none, and I know there is none, but I might have one, you see, and that's enough. Now, you see, such a case can stop from one moment to the other. He simply stops thinking such a foolish thing, you see. But that is exactly what he cannot do. You know it is nonsense, and why should you think it? Or what for should you think it? Well, and what is that power that makes you think such a thing? It's like a possession, you know. Exactly. Yes. Like a demon in him that makes him think like that, in spite of the fact that he doesn't want it. See, then we have the problem. That is the problem for an intellectual man. And then I say, now, you see, you don't know. You have no answer. I have no answer. Now what are we going to do? I say, now we must see what you dream. Because the dream is a manifestation of the unconscious side. Now you never have heard of the unconscious side. So I must explain to him that he has an unconscious. Yeah. And that the dream is a manifestation of it. And if we succeed in analyzing the dream, we might get an idea about that power that makes him think like that. You see? So, in such a case, one can begin right away with the analysis of dreams. And in all cases that are a bit serious, mind you, this is not a simple case, this is a very serious and difficult case, in spite of the simplicity of the phenomenology, of the symptomatology. In all cases, after the preliminaries, as it were, history of the family, the whole medical anamnesis, etc., we come to that question. What is it in your unconscious that makes you wrong, that hinders you to think normally? And then we are there where we can begin with the observation of the unconscious. And then, day by day, one goes on by the data the unconscious produces. You see, we discuss the dream, and that gives a new surface to the whole problem. And he will have another dream, and the next dream gives again an answer, because the unconscious is in a compensatory relation to consciousness. And after a while, we get the full picture. And if he has a full picture and has the necessary moral stamina, well, then he can be cured. But in the end, it is a moral question whether a man applies what he had learned or not.
One typical archetypal form, it is the what they call in alchemy the quadratura circuli, the square in the circle, or the circle in the square. And it is an age-old symbol that goes right back in the prehistory of man, and is all over the earth. And it either expresses the deity or the self. And these two terms are typologically very much related. Which doesn't mean that I believe that God is a self or that the self is God. I make that statement that there is a psychological relation, and that can be have plenty of evidence for it. And it is a very important archetype. It is the archetype of an inner order, and it is always used in that sense, either to make the arrangement of the many, many aspects of the universe, a world scheme, or a scheme of our psyche. And it expresses the fact that there is a center and a periphery. And it tries to embrace the whole. It's a symbol of wholeness. So you see, in a moment where, during a treatment, when there is great disorder and chaos in a man's mind, then this symbol can appear as in the form of a mandala in a dream, or when he makes imaginary fantastical drawings or something of the sort. There it spontaneously appears as a compensatory archetype, bringing order, showing the possibility of order, centeredness. And it means a center which is not coincident with the ego, but with the wholeness, it is wholeness. Our wholeness, which I call the self. Self is the term for wholeness. And I am not whole in my ego. My ego is a fragment of my personality. So you see, that the center of a mandala is not the ego, it is the whole personality.
The whole self.
The center of the whole personality. And it plays a very great role in the East, for instance. But in the Middle Ages equally. And then it has been lost, it has been thought of as a mere sort of allegorical decorative motif. But as a matter of fact, it is highly important and highly autonomous. Symbol that appears in dreams and so on, or in folklore. One could easily say that the main archetype. I had a case that was an intelligent young woman. She was a student of philosophy. Very good mind, where one could expect easily that she would see that I am not the parental authority. But she was utterly unable to get out of this delusion. And in such a case, one always has recourse to the dreams. It is just as if one would ask the unconscious, now what do you say to such a condition? You see, she says, we are unconscious, of course I know you are not my father, but I just feel like that, it is like that, I depend upon you. And I say, now we will see what the unconscious says. Now the unconscious produced dreams in which I really assumed a very curious role. You know, she was the little infant, she was sitting on my knees, I held her in my arms, I was a very tender father to the little girl, you know. And the last dream of that series was, I cannot tell you all the dreams, was that it was out in nature, I stood in a field of wheat, an enormous field of wheat that was ripe for harvest. And I was a child, and I held her in my arm like a baby. And the wind was blowing over that field of wheat. Now, you know, when the wind is blowing over wheat field, these waves in the wheat field.
Yes, yes.
And with these waves, I swayed like that, putting her as if it were to sleep, you know. And she felt as being in the arms of the Godhead. And I thought, now the harvest is ripe, and I must tell her. And I told her, you see, what you want and what you project into me, because you are not conscious of it, is you have the idea of a deity. You don't possess. Therefore, you see it in me. That clicked. Because, you know, she had a rather intense religious education. Of course, it all vanished later on. And something disappeared from her world. Her world became merely personal. And that religious conception of the world was non-existent, apparently. And so she suddenly became aware of an entirely heathenish image that comes fresh from the archetype. She had not the idea of a Christian God or of an Old Testament Yahweh. It was a heathenish god, you see, a god of nature, of vegetation. He was the wheat himself, he was the spirit of the wheat, the spirit of the wind. And she was in the arms of that noumen. No. Now, that is the living experience of an archetype. Now, that made a tremendous impression upon that girl, and instantly it clicked. She saw what she really was missing, that missing value, that was in the form of a projection in myself and made myself indispensable to her.
Yes.
Now that is a luminous experience, you see. And that is the thing that people are looking for. An archetypal experience that gives them an incorruptible value. You see, they depend upon other conditions, they depend upon their desires, their ambitions, depend upon other people, because they have no value in themselves. They have nothing in themselves. They are only rational, and they are not in the possession of a treasure that would make them independent. But when that girl can hold that experience, then she doesn't depend anymore. She cannot depend anymore, because that value is in herself. And that is a sort of liberation. And that is, of course, makes her complete, you know. Inasmuch as she can realize such a luminous experience, she is able to continue her path, her way, her individuation. The acorn can become an oak, and not a donkey. Nature will take her course. She will become that which she is from the beginning.
Thank you. procedure that has many stages, it, or levels. If you treat an ordinary case of neurosis, it may only go as far as healing the symptoms, or giving the patient such an attitude that he can deal with his neurosis. Sometimes it takes you a week, sometimes a few days, sometimes it is just one consultation in which I clean up a case. It is, of course, always the question to know where or what. It needs a good deal of experience, but other cases take very long, and you couldn't send them away because they wouldn't. They want to know more. They make they make the whole process of development. They that goes from stage to stage, a widening out of the mental horizon. You cannot imagine how one-sided people are nowadays. And so it needs no end of work to get people rounded out or mentally more developed, more conscious. And they are so keen on it that for nothing in the world they would quit. And they are not shy of spending money on it. As each plant, each tree grows from a seed and becomes in the end, say, an oak tree, so man becomes what he is meant to be. At least he ought to get there. But most get stuck. They could get much further if they had heard proper things, or if they had spent the necessary time on themselves. But this is not popular, you know, to spend time on oneself, because our point of view is entirely extroverted.
Is a pronouncing of series of images that formulate the life of archetypes. And so the statements of every religion and of many poets and so on are statements about the inner mythological process, which is a necessity, because man is not complete if he is not conscious of that aspect of things. So, you see, a man is not complete when he lives in a world of statistical truth. He must live in a world of his biological truth. That is his biological truth, that is not merely statistics. Yet our natural science makes everything to an average, reduces everything to an average, and of course all the individual qualities are wiped out. That, of course, is most unbecoming. It is unhygienic. It deprives people of their specific values where they are individuals. It deprives them of the most important experiences of their life, where they experience their own value. Maybe the creative background of their personality. And we think we are able to be born today and to live in no myth, without history. That is a disease. That's absolutely abnormal. Because man is not born every day. He is once born in a specific historical setting with the specific historical qualities, and therefore he is only complete when he has a relation to these things. It's just as if you were born without eyes and ears, when you are growing up with no connection with the past. From the natural, with the standpoint of natural science, you need no connection with the past. You can wipe it out. And that is a mutilation of the human being.
The whole personality of man is indescribable. His consciousness can be described. His unconscious cannot be described. Because the unconscious, as I must repeat myself, is always unconscious. And it is really unconscious. It really does not know him. And so we don't know our unconscious personality. We have hints. We have certain ideas, but we don't know it really. Nobody can say where man ends. That is the beauty of it, you know. Yeah. It's very interesting. Yeah. The unconscious of man can reach God knows where. There we are going to make discoveries.
Thank you. Vanderpost is a man of many accomplishments. He's recognized throughout the Western world as a distinguished author and statesman. Perhaps he is most well known for his successful efforts to preserve the life and the culture of the Bushmen of the Kalahari. Vanderpost was born in 1906 in South Africa to a large and distinguished family. At the age of 20, he left South Africa to pursue a career as a journalist in London. During World War II and in the years after, Vanderpost served as a special envoy for Britain in the Far East and in Africa. In 1981, he was knighted for his many years of public services to the Queen. In this conversation, we hear how Vanderpost came to know C.G. Jung of Switzerland. He speaks of the value of Jung's discoveries for the evolution of the modern world. Before this, Vanderpost had expressed his appreciation for Jung and his psychology in two very extensive works. One, a feature-length film on Jung's life, which Vanderpost wrote and produced for the BBC, and the other, a poetic and candid biography of Jung, published in 1975. This conversation took place in the winter of 1978 in the living room of Sir Lawrence's home in Chelsea, where he lives with his wife, Ingeret Giffard, a noted Jungian analyst of London. I would like to hear the story of how you met C.G. Jung in the first place.
Well, it's a very simple and yet a very complicated story, because the odds against my meeting him would have seemed insuperable, because whenever people had spoken to me about him in the past, although I think I have a natural interest in what is called the field of psychology, because of Freud, my experience of Freud, and Jung's association with Freud, I completely rejected Jung, and I wasn't really interested. And then I came back from about 11, 12 years of continuous war, and I was still technically in the British Army, and I just dropped my uniform in London, and I went to Zurich, where my wife happened to be working at the time with Freddie Meyer and Tony Wolfe in particular, and to a certain extent with Emma and C.G. Jung. And then they had one of these sort of parties they had for the Institute, and I was asked to come along, and I found myself put next to Jung. And that's how I met him. And then he happened to be at that moment talking to some eminent Dutch scholar, and they were talking about fire and the meaning of fire. And this Dutch scholar said, "Oh, well, of course, it's just energy, isn't it, fire?" I've never forgotten the look on Jung's face, you know, because if anybody could just think of fire as energy, it was so remote. Of course it's that as well. And I started to join in there, and I told them about how, when I'd been dropped into the jungles of Malaya, I discovered a very interesting primitive tribe called the Sakai, who made fire in a completely different way. And Jung was immediately interested. He said, "How do they make it?" And I said, "Well, it's very wet. It's always raining. So the Sakai will go about naked. They carry a little belt, leather belt. And at the end of this, they have a block of wood, in the center of which is a very deep cylinder. And the top of it is a kind of lid which has a rod attached to it, which fits exactly into the cylinder. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the rod, there's a very deep niche carved. And they have a little leather pouch full of dry moss, and they put the moss into the niche, and they put the cylinder into the rod into the opening of the cylinder, and then they knock the two together. And then they pull it out, and the moss is on fire. And I said to Jung that when I saw this, I had a man who was an engineer with me, and he turned to me and he said, "My God, Colonel, the diesel engine." And that was too much for Jung. And I heard him laugh. He roared with laughter, you know. And the primitive people already, out of the collective unconscious, had the diesel engine principle working, you know. And I think it was that laugh of his which got me. And then we started talking immediately. It's the most extraordinary laugh that Jung had, you know. Because I remember Olga Fröber-Kapteyn, who founded Eranos on the lakes of Ascona, told me that very often when Jung was talking there, and they sat round, they had a great round table at Eranos, where I've sat myself when I lectured there. And just above the table, you had the main road from Italy to Switzerland, and masses of cars going by. And Jung would sit there after the lecture, and they would have wine, and he would laugh. And Olga said it was amazing the numbers of time. Strangers would come down from the road, stop their cars, and say, "Would you mind showing us who that was who laughed just now?" His laugh had that kind of primordial quality of laughter. It was a laugh almost more of somebody who had been infected by the gods than, you know, it was really quite infectious.
You know, I'm very interested in the fact that he had important and deep relationship with women.
It's one of the most important things, my dear, in Jung. One must never think about Jung without remembering his love of and for women, his love of the feminine in man, as well as for the feminine in women, and the service he performed for women, and the enormous service which women performed for him. Because I think myself that in a scientific way, completely scientific way, Jung did for the world what Dante did in a poetic way. Mm. But whereas Dante was inspired by a beautiful feminine face, the face of Beatrice, face of a girl he just saw in the streets of Florence, and which led him from then on right through his life. Jung had the shattering originality to be inspired by what you might call the ugly face of womankind. Hmm. Jung had an instinct that what was wrong with life, what made life tear apart, made it incomplete, was because the feminine was rejected. And even in his very, very first book, which he called The Psychology of the Unconscious, I think it's now called Roots of the Unconscious, which led to his break with Freud. Because if there's one thing that Freud didn't have conspicuously in his makeup, it was a sense of the importance of the feminine. I mean, Freud was very much an Old Testament phenomenon. He was a prophet. He was a very great man. I'm not saying this to belittle him, but merely to understand him. He was a very great person, a very great pioneer to whom we owe a lot. But he was an Old Testament phenomenon. I think more of Jung as a New Testament phenomenon. But Jung had this sense of the rejected feminine enormously. When you go back into his life And particularly if you go into the case histories which he's left behind in the Burgholtzi, which I've done, it's very, very interesting to me how most of the cases that really gripped him were the cases of women who had gone, as they called it then, insane. And there was this famous case of this woman, I think her name was Babette, who in the Burgholtzli Hospital, who'd been there for donkey's years, the one who said, you know, Naples and I, between us, must supply the world with spaghetti. And everybody said, my God, she's crazy. Do you see? She's crazy. What is she talking about? To Jung, it was very significant because he saw in this a law of compensation that she was trying to put herself into an important role because she was feeling neglected. She'd lost her identity. And he learned an enormous amount from this old lady. And when Freud visited Jung in Zurich for the first time, Jung took Freud to see this old lady. And Freud said to Jung afterwards, yes, I can see that she's an interesting case, but isn't she a hideous old lady? I would hate to spend my time with her. And to Jung, this was quite a shock, he told me. It nearly bowled him over because he'd never thought of her in those terms. That's what I mean, that he could follow, not like Dante, the outward beauty and face of womankind, as most men do, but he could follow the inner face, the averted, the rejected face of women. And so it was not surprising that when he came across the papers and the case of this extraordinary Miss Miller, who had these fantasies, that he could follow her in her fantasies. And that was his first feminine guide, was a deranged feminine spirit, driven insane, driven mad by a world of men, rejected by a masculine dominated world. Now, Jung worked in this rejected feminine world of the unconscious for years. People came to him. He was particularly successful with women patients. And one person came into his life very early on, because she's already with Jung, and Emma Jung at the famous conference in Vienna, where they are all photographed together, and that is Toni Wolff. Now, Toni Wolff, whatever the diagnosis was, it was a very serious diagnosis. A lot of people who knew her said that they despaired of her ever recovering from whatever her psychological disturbance was. I think one must accept that it was profound enough to fit the rare, exceptional spirit that she was, because in a sense, the rarer, the more exceptional the spirit, the deeper the psychological suffering. And Jung managed to bring her out of this, so that by the time of the famous Vienna conference, she was already an integrated working personality. And to me, that photograph is very moving, because the one who looks young, as if she's just been born, is Toni Wolff. To take it down into the level where it belongs, you see that all the time that Jung was working with the rejected feminine, he was, in a sense, working by projection, to use the term which he coined. And because he was dealing with the feminine through the lives of the rejected feminine in others, an immense charge was building up in himself. And that time when he let himself go, and when he landed deep down in what he came to call the collective unconscious, all this rejected feminine in himself confronted him. And I think this becomes very, very clear in that dream which he tells in Dreams, Memories and Reflections. It's a dream in which Jung again goes down, and he finds somebody whom he thinks is the prophet Elijah sitting there. And there's a great snake. And there's a young girl whom he thinks is Salome, who's blind. And Jung in Dreams, Memories and Reflections, to my amazement, Jung deals in such detail with all his other dreams. He says, oh, well, he said, you know, the old man, the sage, and the young girl, it's a frequent theme. You find it in Lao Tse, and you find it in myths and legends, and that's all there is about it. Well, that wasn't what all that is about it. I think this is the moment of Jung's greatest psychological peril. He's confronted with the fact that like the whole of mankind, he himself, that he's anima, he's soul, in this aspect is blind. What happens in this period? This is the time when Tony Wolfe took over. This is the time. Tony Wolfe was not blind. She'd been in this world before. She was the only one who knew it. And she took over from Salome. And she conducted in this unfamiliar, terrifying underground of the collective unconscious. She was Jung's guide to such an extent that she lived with him. And she took over the whole of the burden. And of course, the tensions caused by that in Zurich and in the family must have been tremendous. But it was done quite openly, lived out quite openly. And I don't think that if it had not been for Tony Wolfe, that Jung really could have survived and could have done the work on the collective unconscious in the manner that he did it, that we all owe it. This is a debt that we owe Tony Wolfe, and the only way to repay it to somebody who's dead is to talk about it and to give it decent recognition. And in a sense, that's what women have had to do throughout history. They've, in a sense, they've had to train their own men, as it were, to become responsible for their own feminine selves. And to see not only the external, but the inner side of women. And Jung himself had the greatness to prepare the reflection of himself, because that was what Tony Wolfe was, and what these rejected women were, to train himself for this moment so that he would have an instrument at his side to complete the work which men and women have to do between them on earth. And I think that's very, very, that to me is one of the most important accomplishments of Jung, which led to this discovery then of the masculine in the feminine, of the animus and the anima, and that for the first time on earth now, instead of men being just a twosome or being a threesome, we're a foursome. We're so much stronger. The square is there. The masculine within the feminine and the feminine within the man. There are four. And therefore, I think it makes the relationships between men and women much more difficult because they're more complex, but also makes them more meaningful and the potential infinitely greater. And to me, perhaps one of the most moving things of all is that Mrs. Jung, Emma Jung, said to a close friend of mine just before she died, that she had never ceased to be grateful in her life for Tony Wolfe, because Tony Wolfe was able to do for her husband something that she could not have done. Jung wrote, "I cannot define for you what God is. I cannot tell you even that God is. But what I can say is that all my work has scientifically proved that the pattern of God exists in every man, and that this pattern has at its disposal the greatest transforming energies of which mankind is capable." Thank you.
Thank you.